Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. My name is Danny Nierenberg, and I am president and co-founder of Food Tank, and I'm also a proud member of the Barilla Foundation Advising Board. Before we begin, let me just share some housekeeping. This event is live on Zoom, YouTube, Twitter, and both the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition and Food Tank websites. And we also invite you to contribute to this global discussion using the hashtag Double Pyramid across all social media and offer your comments, your experiences, criticism, and suggestions. It is my and Food Tank's sincere pleasure to partner with the Barilla Foundation and UNESCO Italy on today's conversation around the Double Pyramid, which combines both a health and a climate pyramid. The last year has shown us the importance of healthy diets. COVID-19 is not just a deadly virus, but a diet-related disease. And while climate change hasn't received as much attention as it should because of the pandemic, the urgency of addressing the climate crisis is unfortunately greater than ever before. But we have a real opportunity and a responsibility to reset our food systems from farm to fork and even beyond. We need food and agriculture systems that provide adequate and equitable food for all, and that don't pose an undue burden on ecosystems, biodiversity, or livelihoods. It's clear that our health and the health of the environment are inextricably linked. We need collaboration and transdisciplinary approaches around a one health model that realizes the interconnectedness between humans, animals, plants, and their shared environment. And what is exciting to me is that the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition's Health and Climate Pyramid appreciate and honor the richness of culinary and dietary traditions and diversity across the globe. Unlike recent reports on global diets, the Double Pyramid doesn't prescribe one diet for all. Instead, it recognizes how farmers, indigenous peoples, elders, and cooks of all ages and cultures have been producing healthy and sustainable diets for hundreds of generations. Diets that are nutrient dense, plant forward, and probably most important of all, delicious. So today we'll be hearing from experts around the globe who understand the challenges we face in creating a better food system, but also understand the incredible solutions and innovations that are working every day in kitchens, farms, laboratories, boardrooms, town halls, and universities and schoolrooms across the world. I think that's probably enough for me for now. It's now time to get started. I'm pleased to share a welcome address from Mr. Guido Barilla, the chair of the Barilla Foundation.
Good afternoon, good morning, everyone. Today we will explore an issue that I really care about, the relationship between people and planetary health, as the future of both are very linked. Food affects and is affected by every aspect of our life, from our culture and traditions, our health, longevity, and well-being, and the condition of our precious environmental resources. Today, in the decade of action to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, we need to accelerate action to reset the food system from farm to fork. If we want to be bold, we need to break the silos that often exist around human health and environment, and instead look at them together. Already in 2010, the Barilla Foundation worked to show this deep interconnection by developing the Double Pyramid, a tool aimed at encouraging and promoting informed, healthy, and sustainable food choices. People, each of us, have the power to shape the future we want 3 times a day through our food choices. By adopting a sustainable diet, we can take care of our health and also contribute to releasing the pressure on the planet that will be able to nourish future generations. Today we will present the new Double Pyramid based on a rigorous scientific approach, showing that the right kind of varied and balanced diet can help us to achieve a better health and a less climate impact, while being flexible and inclusive enough for us to keep with it day after day. The new Double Pyramid is aimed to reach policymakers, agri-food companies, educators, and citizens. And it means to contribute to the shift towards a more sustainable diets, also by leveraging synergies between food, education and culture. Importantly, this year we have also shown how the double pyramid can be applied to 7 main regions around the world. In doing so, I want to stress that sustainability produced high quality nutrient-dense food must be accessible and affordable for all, respectful of the role of food actors in fostering change in global food system, as custodian of valuable tradition and local food cultures. I'm very happy to be here with you today. During our forum in December 2020, I said that the future is in everybody's hands. And today we will deliver in the hands of citizens, chefs, policymakers, the scientific community a new concrete tool that empowers everyone, everywhere, to make healthy and sustainable food choices. This is humanity's cultural mission for our future. Thanks to the speakers who join us today, and I wish you all a fruitful and inspiring conversation.
Thank you so much, Chairperson Barilla. I'm really appreciative of what you had to say about the importance of breaking down silos and making sure that we are aware of the need to be as inclusive as possible as we seek solutions to our most pressing challenges around the food system. And you also reminded us that the future is in everyone's hands. The double pyramid is a valuable tool. It's a tool that can help us nourish both people and the planet today, tomorrow, and well into the future. I'm excited to introduce our first panel. For all of our speakers today, the panels and discussions are very quick, so I ask all of you to keep your answers and remarks short and to the point. So now let's discover more about the One Health approach through the double pyramid model with Barbara Buchner and Million Belay. Their panel will focus on the double pyramid, a global approach to food sustainability. Barbara is the Global Managing Director at the Climate Policy Initiative, and Million is the General Coordinator of the Alliance for Food Sovereignty in Africa. Welcome to you both. So Barbara, I'd love to start with you. Can you explain how the health and climate double pyramid can help eaters understand the climate impacts of our production and consumption practices?
Sure, and thank you so much for having me today. It's a true pleasure being here, and as always, I'm very passionate about this topic. So I think also as a board member of the Barilla Foundation, I'd just like to go back to the, you know, where the Barilla double pyramid basically came from, and just like give the audience a little bit more of the background of how innovative this concept actually is and how it can help you do the right food choices. I think just it is important to recall that the original double pyramid was actually published back in 2010, so that's more than 10 years ago. And it provided the first strong signal of the importance of careful and conscientious food choices, bringing evidence that what we eat does not only affect our health, but also the environment. And that finding was fundamental to move the debate out of silos. And to me, it was the first step to really find solutions that work for both the planet's and the people's well-being. So what the double pyramid has communicated from its first edition is that foods which nutritionists recommend consuming more frequently for their health benefits are those which have a lower environmental impact. And foods with high environmental impact should instead be consumed with moderation because of the effects that they can have on health. So that's a very powerful finding. And maybe just to say, as every innovative research that pushes boundary, and that was again more than 10 years ago, there were many data and methodological gaps. And over the years, the initial double pyramid model has really been transformed into a real line of research, improving the data coverage, but also going deeper into specific nutrition models, depending on geographies and actor groups. And all that has culminated in this latest set of double pyramids, which really has been developed with a basis of a much better methodology, which takes into account the latest research and evidence on the impact of food choices on health and environment, just going beyond the past approaches that we have. And now just coming back, sorry, to your questions, sure. All this evidence really confirms that through a varied and balanced diet, we can promote our health, our longevity, our well-being by reducing the carbon footprint. And in fact, the foods that should be consumed more frequently for our health are also those that have a lower climate impact. And so I think the overall message that we get from the double pyramid remained the same over the last 10 years, but we have many more nuances now. We have much more information that really helps us, you and me, to better understand you know, what we should consume and how in parallel our food choices really help us reduce the impact of food consumption and production on climate change. So I think this is super powerful. And I think the second message just that I feel is really powerful, and you also mentioned that in your opening remarks actually, is that there are no bad foods. I think this is something that I feel sometimes gets lost in the discussion. All foods can be part of a healthy and sustainable diet as long as you pay attention to the proper frequency of consumption and serving sizes. And again, I think all this is more important today than ever, because here we are facing the greatest challenge of our time, if not of human history, climate change. We really need all help.
Hi, everyone. Apologies for the technical difficulties. I think Barbara said some really powerful things about how, you know, we have much more information than we did 10 years ago when the double pyramid was first developed. And there's a real focus on the nuance around how to eat for a better climate. Milione, I'd love to bring you into this discussion now and talk a little bit about, you know, some of those nuances that Barbara mentioned. You know, there's a real urgency to make change right now. And I think one of the most interesting things about the double pyramid is the focus on cultural diversity and the cultural pyramids that we'll talk about a little bit later. Can you explain a little bit about the concept of right to food and how equity and equality are really linked to healthy and sustainable diets?
Thank you very much, Barbara. Thank you. Thank you, Danielle, and thank you also the BCFN for inviting me. I think to do a cultural pyramid is a very ambitious work. I've read the African part. To do an African double pyramid is really, really ambitious, but the people who have tried to do that have done quite a good job. That's because, you know, the continent is a very diverse and varied continent. Even if I speak about my country, you know, the food in the northern part of the country, the southern and the pastoralist part of the country is quite different. So, but it was a good start that we have started to talk about cultural double pyramids. But I, before I answer your question, Daniel, I just wanted to link the food and culture in the African context. And there are four pillars for me. The first is spirituality, you know, food, spirituality, spirituality due to food. And a lot of communities do have, the rituals around seeds and around food, and also fasting. You know, where we half of the Ethiopians right now are fasting, in Orthodox Christianity tradition. Out of the 360 days, we almost fast in half of the year. So that spiritual tradition is very critical to food, because the kind of food that you eat is different. And the second is livelihood. Food is a medicine in our culture. Food is a health issue. Food is a social issue. It's a nutritious issue, because the diversity that you have in the seeds and in other materials in our food system is very much critical. And what we don't talk about so much is knowledge is around the food system, and sure, the language around the system, and the songs, the stories and proverbs around the food system. These are very, very much critical, because in Ethiopia, for example, you have over 100 varieties of wheat, 60 varieties of barley, and this diversity is nothing without the knowledge associated with it. Right. And women know how to process it, and they have names for it. So it's very critical. And the last part is food governance, and the governance is very much important. So when we talk about equity and the right to food, we're talking about these elements of the food system. There are two tenets of food sovereignty in general. It's a local ownership on one hand, and self-sufficiency on the other hand. If I start with self-sufficiency, for example, in time of COVID, when we had this challenge, is still having the challenge in Africa and all over the world, communities who are self-sufficient in their food production are faring better. And the moment you change that system and you make those communities like a dumping ground for food that's coming from the outside, then that's problematic. So that's food sovereignty for you. And local ownership of land, ownership of seed, ownership of even the knowledge that you have that I've talked about, it's so critical. So this is the tenets of food sovereignty. So in the context of the right to food, I think there are right holders, which are those who are producing food or processing food, and also the duty bearers, which are governments, So it's a relationship between the two. So every government and every institution has a responsibility to ensure that people have the right to food. And that is exercised in our context, in the context of food sovereignty, because food sovereignty talks about equity, and food sovereignty kind of problematizes the food relationship that we have right now, because there is a power discrepancy in the food system.
Absolutely.
So that's what I would love to say.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that very clear explanation. A final question for you both. The health and climate pyramid is very unique. And then we have these cultural pyramids. Again, they don't prescribe a one-size-fits-all approach. And they're not about eliminating major food groups or demanding everyone go vegan, but really respecting food cultures and the impact of our food production and consumption choices. So I'm wondering from you both, how can everyone from farmers, Milion, to finance experts, Barbara, really, expand what the idea of a sustainable and healthy diet looks like? Barbara, why don't you go first?
And apologies again for the technical glitch before. Well, I think, for me, finance is a key ingredient on really making sure that we're getting on kind of this sustainable pathway, and that brings us to a better future. And in this context, clearly food systems are an extremely important part. I mean, if you just think about the food production, which is responsible for up to 37% of net greenhouse gases of anthropogenic origin. So we really got to think about, our food systems being both a contributor to climate change, but also one of those that are most affected by climate change and, loss of biodiversity and everything. And I believe, we have seen that most progressive businesses really have already accepted that protecting, health and the planet makes economic sense. But what we are not seeing yet is the investments that we need in order to get a sustainable agri-food system. I think we only see at the moment that there are a fraction of what is needed to drive systemic change. We only have about 8% of public climate finance, which currently is directed to the agri-food system, and that is exacerbating food security in many issues. So we really need to change that. And so, you know, to your question, we do see that there are a number of sustainable investment models which unite the public and private partners that already exist today. My organization, we're working on a number of them through an incubator and accelerator program that's called the Global Innovation Lab for Climate Finance, with a specific stream on sustainable food systems, where we're developing financial ideas and business models that really can improve the sustainability and resilience of food systems across the value chain, from growing to processing and distribution. So just maybe let me give you one example, just to show that that is actually existing, but you know, obviously we need much more of that. But there's an example which is called the Responsible Commodities Facility, and that addresses some of the growing demand, global demand for soy, which is linked to agriculture expansion and deforestation in Brazil. But it does provide attractive loan conditions to really incentivize soy producers to use land that has already been cleared in Brazil, rather than farming virgin land. And there's other business models that exist that provide financial support from farm to fork, creating jobs along the entire supply chain, conditional sustainable food practices. But again, coming back, I think there is a lot of models out there, but what we need is really to get from the models, from the pilot to real scale. So we need both to replicate what works, but we also need innovation and continue to drive innovation also in the financial models to ensure that we get to the scale of investments that can get us to a better future that's better for the planet and for all of us.
Absolutely. So Milian, you know, Barbara has mentioned a lot of these models that are out there, but some of the most progressive and innovative models are done by farmers themselves. And I'm wondering if you can address that.
Yeah, I think, you know, AFSA is a broad-based institution. We have farmers, fisher folks, pastoralists, indigenous peoples, consumer groups, and youth groups, women groups, you know, faith-based institutions. And we have identified a path for a better food system and for a better climate. And that path is agroecology, because it ticks so many critical areas. It ticks food production. We have to produce food. But we have to produce healthy and nutritious food. But we have to produce this healthy and nutritious food without impacting the environment. You know, the biodiversity in water and climate and the land, everything. And we have to produce culturally appropriate food. As I said, you know, culture, I explained what the pillars of culture are, and it has to maintain that, you know. Every time I come to some European countries, like Italy, for example, the culture of food culture is fantastic. I think it's not only African, it's global.
Everywhere.
And also, we have to produce food without impacting the rights of people. So human rights and right to food is very much critical. So agroecology ticks all of these boxes, and we are for agroecology.
What a great point to end on for this panel, Milian and Barbara. I'm sorry, we have to move on. Thank you both so much for your contribution today. And I you know, there's so many great things about how agroecology and agriculture itself can really be the solution to the climate crisis. Thank you both again.
Thank you.
Thanks so much.
I'm now really excited to bring Brent Locke in into this conversation. He's the global lead scientist at the World Wildlife Fund. Brent, it's such an honor to have you with us, and I'm thrilled you can really help us expand this important discussion.
Danielle, it's great to be here, and you know, you really gotta love Zoom with all these tech glitches, right? But you handled that really, really beautifully. Good job.
Thanks so much. So, you know, my first question for you is, as we emerge from the pandemic, how do we get tools like the Double Health and Climate Pyramid and all of the amazing work that the WWF is doing in front of influencers, not just policymakers, but, you know, farmers and eaters who can really make the changes that are needed in their daily lives?
You know, the same way that Coca-Cola, Pepsi, and McDonald's are doing it. You know, what I think that they do such a really good job. I mean, they've got brilliant marketing campaigns.
Right.
They spend a lot of money in marketing, a lot of money in advertisements, whereas it seems like the healthy, sustainable food folks feel like the communications or marketing budget can be somehow secondary, can be put over here. You know, the problem with Pepsi and Coca-Cola and some of the junk food is that they're targeting kids. Right. They're targeting adults, and kids are bombarded by these junk food advertisements all the time, telling them that if you eat this food, you're gonna be able to run faster. It's exciting. This is modern. This is the type of food that you should be eating. And what we have to do is we have to do the same thing with healthy and sustainable food. We have to make it interesting. We have to make it fun. We have to make it exciting, and we have to invest the money into it to be able to get them in front of as many people as we can. But we can't just depend on the individual consumer. We also have to look at policies. We have to have the policies in place. We have to have the right regulations, in place so that we create the right food environment. We just have to do a much better job of actually communicating this. We know that the science is out there. There's overwhelming evidence saying that healthy, sustainable diets is what we need to be able to actually feed the planet. That's where we need to be heading. And we have to get out of our ivory towers. I think we have a moral responsibility to be able to communicate this with people, to, be able to develop the message and share that with everybody out there.
Absolutely. I'm glad you brought up this sort of responsibility that we all have and the storytelling and the communication. But when you're, you mentioned how corporations are targeting children, they're also targeting ultra processed foods to the global south. And Milione and Barbara were talking about, cultural diversity and the importance of maintaining those rich cultural traditions around food. How do we combat that?
That's the thing about cultures. Culture can work against us because it's a continually changing concept, right? Culture is never the static idea. In many places, what we're seeing is that, these traditional foods are actually considered as the poor man's food. We don't want to eat that because that's old fashioned or it's not modern and that's something that we're going to have to combat. It's this resurgence of these traditional foods and the pride, that these foods have.
Sure.
And so many of them are healthy. It's not about transforming diets. It's about holding on to what you already have. Don't follow the path of and make the mistakes that so many countries have done. Just hold on to it. You've been doing it for thousands of years. It's worked. Let's keep on doing it.
Well, and that's where marketing and communication, I think, have a big role to play, really returning, from this idea of poor people's foods that you mentioned to these are the foods that will sustain us. These are the foods of the future.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So for our final question with you, I'm always interested when I talk to folks like you, that are working on these issues every day and making real change. How optimistic are you that we can reach some of the goals that are outlined in the Double Health and Climate Pyramid and that are outlined in the Sustainable Development Goals? How can we, how hopeful are you that we can make the changes that will, turn the climate crisis around, turn our food systems around?
I'll talk about optimism first and I'll talk about hope second. I would say that I'm optimistic that we can actually create the changes that we need. And the reason that I am with food is that thing that we all have some kind of opinion about. We eat it, we fall in love over it. We have conversations about it. It's something that we all think that we're experts about food, right? And it's so embedded into our culture. So of course with food, we have that real leverage points. So yes, I'm optimistic that food gives us that opportunity. What worries me though, is that can we create the change in the time that we need? I think we still want to nibble at the edges. We want to say, well, let's make small changes, small changes to be able to do just small things to the food system. But gone are the days where we can just implement small changes, these incremental changes. We have to figure out and realize that the next decade is the most important decade for us, for our species to be able to thrive on this, on Earth. And we need this exponential, action. Now on the hope side of the things, I don't place my North Star isn't hope, because I think that hope and motivation can kind of waver. Some days you're really hopeful and, some days you wake up and you're not hopeful at all.
Sure.
But I don't actually place so that's not really my North Star. What my North Star is really, it's hard work. It's the hard work, it's a daily commitment because, the challenges that we're facing are gonna require us to get up every single day, whether you're motivated or whether you're hopeful or not, and to be able to do what needs to be done. There's a great quote by Buckminster Fuller that says something about whether it's gonna be utopia or whether we're gonna face our ultimate extinction is gonna be a tight, really race to the very end. You know, and that's going to mean in 2030, we're not done, or 2040, we're not done, and 2050, we're not done. We're going to have to get up every single day. We're going to have to keep on working, and this is going to go on forever. And that's why we need more people like you working in this, Danielle. The work that you're doing is absolutely spectacular. So thank you for your work. And yeah, we definitely need a lot more people like you doing this.
Oh, I feel the same about you. And you're right. This is a long haul. This is not something that will happen overnight. The urgency is too great. And incremental changes, as you mentioned, are not enough. Thank you so much. You're so inspiring. Such an honor to have you with us.
Thank you so much, Daniel. Take care.
Thank you. You too. So our next panel is on creating a better food, agriculture, and nutrition policies. Our panelists include Elise Golan, the Director for Sustainable Development at the U.S. Department of Agriculture, Gabriele Riccardi, a Professor of Endocrinology and Metabolic Diseases at the University of Naples, Leonard Mizzi, the Head of a Unit Sustainable Agri-Food Systems and Fisheries for the European Union, and Sophie Heike, the Head of Consumer Science at the European Food Information Council. If you could all turn on your videos, it would be great to see you and unmute yourselves. Thank you so much. Thank you all for joining. It's an honor to have you here. Gabriele, I'd like to start with you. We have a slide that I'd like our team to pull up about the research that's been done behind the double pyramid. And my question to you is, how can the double pyramid encourage food systems that enable both better human health and better planetary health?
Thank you, Danny. I'm very proud of the opportunity to describe briefly the work which is behind this pyramid, particularly for the health part of it, for which I'm responsible for my group. You see, we know that there is an epidemic of overweight all over the world, and this has very important health consequences. And looking at that, we understand that it is very urgent to change the way we eat, because there is a very clear link between our diet and many non-communicable diseases. In particular, we know, for instance, that 9 million premature deaths from cardiovascular disease worldwide, which account for as much as 50% of all the cardiovascular deaths, could be preventable by an healthy diet. So you see, it's this picture highlights what a powerful tool would be, an improvement of dietary pattern in order to subdue the burden of health disease globally. Now, we know that an healthy diet, not excluding any food, but focused on fruit, vegetables, nuts, legumes, whole grains, and non-tropical vegetable oil will be able to contribute very importantly to reduce non-communicable disease on a global level. However, if we look at the trends in dietary habits worldwide, the picture is not at all reassuring, because in recent years, we have seen a mismatch between the knowledge among scientists and health professional and the real habits of the population, since very modest risk modification is occurred. Now, this might be due, among other reasons, to the difficulties to communicate in a very easy, understandable way the relationship between specific food choices and health at the global level, including people with a very low cultural level. The health pyramid can represent a clear, effective, communicative instrument to advise people on the frequency of consumption of each food. In the past, the pyramid was based mostly on a consensus among scientists. And this has been, also sometimes utilized to not give the full credibility of this approach. So the work that we have done is that we have utilized an evidence-based methodology. We have searched all the literature which was linking each food choice with health outcomes, particularly cardiovascular disease. So by doing so, we have been able to quantify the impact of each food choice on the risk of cardiovascular disease. Some food choices are protective, for instance, whole grain, vegetable food. Some are neutral, like for instance, the consumption of poultry or eggs. Some instead can have a deleterious impact on the risk of cardiovascular disease, like for instance, red and processed meat. Now, by utilizing this information, according also to an appropriate statistical tools, we have been able to rank all the different foods for their frequency of consumption, which would get the best impact on our health and particularly on cardiovascular disease. So we have some foods which are on the basement of the pyramid, like whole grain, vegetable, fruit, which should be consumed even more in more occasion during the day. Then in the intermediate, we have some types of food which instead have a neutral impact on the risk and can be consumed within some moderate frequency and serving size. And then on the top, we have the food which should be only utilized occasionally. So the real advantage of this approach is that no food is left out of the pyramid.
Great.
It can eat everything. The problem is to make the right choice on the frequency and on the serving size.
So portions are really important, aren't they?
I think it is important, also because this approach has been also complemented by this cultural pyramid, which have taken into account, as has been also discussed by previous speakers, different cultural traditions. So everyone in each country, whatever is the background culinary tradition, can find the right foods that should be promoted and some food that is said to be utilized only occasionally. So it's, you see, this is also an important tool to have a different type of globalization. So far we have had a kind of a fast food globalization, where some dietary habits imported from some particularly cultural, particularly industrial products have been diffused all over the world. Now we want instead to have a reverse trend, to learn the good way of eating, which is healthy and sustainable from all the different culinary cultures.
Absolutely, and that's what Milion mentioned before, that you know I think is so important, that we have to understand the rich cultural traditions that have sustained societies for generations. I'm sorry, I need to move on and talk to some of the other folks on the panel. And Elisa, I'm wondering if I can turn to you. You and the U.S. Department of Agriculture in the United States have been preparing for the UN Food Systems Summit. And I'm wondering how you see the double pyramid in this context of preparing for some of the international goals and not necessarily policies, but international goals that will come out of the summit.
Thanks, Danny, and thanks for inviting me to this really interesting discussion. And you're right, the U.S. has been preparing for the UN Food Systems Summit, and we strongly support the summit. We view it as a timely and valuable opportunity to focus the world's attention on our shared goals of improving nutrition, ending hunger, building more sustainable, equitable, resilient food systems. The summit also represents an important opportunity for the world to consider a new approach to food and ag policy. And that's a food systems approach. You know, a systems approach where we really systematically and holistically consider all the complexity of a food system. You know, all the entire network of the activities and outputs related to the production, processing, distribution, preparation, consumption of food. The UN Committee on World Food Security took a food systems approach in their recently released voluntary guidelines on food systems and nutrition. Now, these voluntary guidelines underscore the complexity of food systems, including the complexity between the relationship of the relationship between healthy diets and food systems. These voluntary guidelines stress that the sustainability of a food is not an intrinsic property of the food, but that depends on the sustainability of the food systems in which it was produced. The guidelines further stress that food systems are dynamic and are constantly being shaped by different forces and drivers. So my concern with the double pyramid is that the guidance embedded in the double pyramid does not reflect truly a systems approach or the complexity or the dynamism of food systems. At this very moment around the world, there are producers, manufacturers, distributors, grocery store, food system actors in every corner of the world who are improving the sustainability of their production practices and systems. Many of those producing foods in that high impact part of the double pyramid have already made incredible gains in the sustainability of their products. Nevertheless, the double pyramid has these producers locked into this tier in the pyramid. No matter what these producers do, them and their food, they are stuck. They cannot break out of their pyramid ranking. And maybe even more concerning is that producers who are producing food in the low impact part of the pyramid, they don't have an incentive to improve the sustainability of their systems. Because no matter what they do, how much they pollute, or mistreat the soil or waste scarce water resources, they and the foods they produce will remain at the good end of the scale. So because the double pyramid is locking producers and food into a particular tier in the scale, they don't really recognize the dynamic nature of food systems and the heterogeneity of producers. Because of that, I'm afraid that the double pyramid could send the wrong message and could actually disincentivize the adoption of more sustainable production and consumption patterns.
Sure. And you know, what we've heard throughout this discussion is that no food is good or bad. And I think that's a powerful point that the double pyramid is making. But Gabriele, do you want to take a few minutes to address Elisa's concerns?
Yes, I think this criticism is appropriate. But we should consider that we had a previous version of the double pyramid, which was produced 10 years ago. That was based on the knowledge that at that time we had about the relationship between food and health and food and the ecological impact. Now, after 10 years, we have changed the pyramid. Some of the foods are still on the same layers, but some have changed, because the knowledge we have acquired during these 10 years has given us the information to realize that something had to change. For instance, now we have clearly divided all grain foods from refined cereal foods with an high glycemic index, because during these 10 years, we have got clear information from the epidemiological studies that all grain has not should not be considered at the same level as refined food in relation to the impact on cardiovascular risk and on diabetes and cancer. And so we have changed the double pyramid. This is not going to last forever. This is the pyramid we have produced now. It is appropriate because it reflects the state of the art at this specific time in the history. But obviously, when the information will change, when we will understand something more about foods that have changed, the way meat is produced, we want to push the production of cattle in a different way. And I'm confident that in 10 years from now, we will have a different type of meat on the market. Well, when that information will be available, when this data will be produced, we will be very pleased. We and the other people will follow us to change the double pyramid and to make different layers. But at the present, I'm confident the double pyramid reflects the state of the art. And so it is an efficient tool for the consumers to make the appropriate choices.
But I love that you said that, you know, this is not set in stone. There is a dynamism to it that it can change. Leonard and Sophie, I really want to bring you into this discussion. And, you know, in so many ways, Leonard, Europe is so far ahead of much of the world and how you think about food. The European Union has come up with far-reaching and innovative policies around a Green New Deal, a farm-to-fork strategy. I'm wondering, what, from your perspective, what can other countries, you know, including the United States, where Elise and I live, you know, how can we learn from these initiatives?
Thank you, Danielle, and thanks to the Barilla Center for this event. As Elise said, the UN Food Systems Summit is potentially a game changer in the coming months, and we need to use the momentum. Brett mentioned about optimism or utopia. I consider that in the next 6 to 8 months, if we can't really transform the global governance with embedding it in a national and regional approach, then this would be a missed opportunity. We have the UN Food Systems Summit. We had Nutrition for Growth in December. We have Kunming in October, which is on biodiversity. We have Glasgow. We have G7, G20. And for the first time, there is a convergence of thoughts between the biodiversity, between the climate change and the food systems. So first of all, it's the need to dismantle the silos of the ministries of agriculture, ministries of environment, ministries of health. Communicating, because we have policies, as you mentioned, as European Union, we now have policies. We have the EU Green Deal, we have the Farm to Fork, we have the biodiversity strategy, and we're rolling this out. But we will also want to communicate and accompany our partner countries with our private sector, because what I didn't hear until now is how to do the behavioral economics nudging aspect. Sure. Is a voluntary approach enough? Evidently, it's not enough. Just thinking that on the basis consumers will react rationally, it will not work necessarily. So we are also thinking, and we're giving the example of deforestation-free value chains. Barbara mentioned the challenges around deforestation free value chains, from soya to livestock to palm oil, cocoa, and through, first of all, a legislative proposal which will come out later this year on deforestation free value chains. So a legislative approach which will hopefully also do that impact from a legislative point of view in order to stop, to halt, to reverse deforestation in a number of countries. Secondly, due diligence. Again, a legislative proposal on due diligence. So this requires a multi-stakeholder, as Millian mentioned. It requires a full integration of the operators from the cocoa farmer in Côte d'Ivoire and Ghana to the final producer, final processor and final consumer. And that's what we are trying to tackle. In terms of deforestation, in terms of child labor, in terms of human rights-based approach and inclusiveness. This is not going to be easy because it's intersectoral, it's interdisciplinary, and COVID is an extra layer of complexity because we are coming out with indebtedness of the countries, where as well food systems, let's be honest amongst ourselves, is not necessarily at the highest core of the international agenda, because vaccines is the most important issue at the moment in terms of rollout. So, and that is also important. What is the policy dialogue at country level to engage in terms of smart policies? Because it's good to say we need to consume more fruit and vegetables.
Sure.
There are excess of fruit and vegetables in some countries. We know of deserts and islands of pockets, even in the developed world, where you don't find affordable fruit and vegetables. COVID also showed lockdowns has created impacts in terms of waste. For example, fruit and vegetables wasted because there was no connectivity. So I think it requires really a policy dialogue, and it's up to us as donor community, but also with the private sector, because the private sector is also resisting to invest in inclusive value chains. Why? Because the transactional costs are too high. So de-risking, blending, guarantees also need to accompany this, but it's important to have a blend of voluntary but also legislative approaches to really do the transformation.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for that. And I love what you said about breaking down silos. And, you know, you mentioned behavioral economics. And Sophie, I want to talk about, you know, consumers' role in all this, because discussions around food and agriculture are often so siloed. And how do we bring more eaters into this, into these discussions, you know, around what food policy should look like? Of course, you've pointed out to me that European consumers are very diverse. But I'm wondering how we make sure that they aren't confused about what healthy and sustainable diets look like, and that they're not confused about legislation around, you know, healthier food policy.
Yes, thank you so much, Danielle. And also thank you so much for having me today. I really loved what Leonard was just saying. And I also wanted to build a little bit on what Brent was saying earlier on. As a behavioral scientist, obviously my answer is behavioral insights. I mean, we start with the more kind of basic studies. The European Consumer Organization just issued a report last year, and they could show that across many different European countries, people tend to underestimate the impacts that their diet has on the climate and on the environment. And they actually also overestimate how healthy and sustainable they already eat. And that's a good starting point, understanding how they make sense of their own dietary behavior. We can then take it further. We can look at research showing us that people want more information. They want to have sustainability information on foods. And at the same time, we also know that this doesn't actually impact their behavior. So I fundamentally believe that we need those behavioral insights. Lena was mentioning nudging as an approach. So behavioral economics is really all about saying, we know the people, humans, us, we don't act rationally as much as we would love to think that we do. We don't.
Sure.
So how do we behave? What really impacts us? We know a huge part is our immediate environment, our choice environment. That's why we talk about choice architecture, maybe changing the outlet of a supermarket, but maybe also running campaigns for behavior change that are far more than just information. As much as I love, you know, the different approaches, I think what Barilla has developed with the double pyramid is a really great approach, but just dispersing the information is not going to help. Just communicating around this is not going to help. We need to find smarter ways to create people's willingness to change, people's willingness and eagerness and interest to actually want to do something else. Huh? And sometimes it's nudging, where you help people by changing the environment so that it's easier for them to make a better, a healthier, and a sustainable choice. And sometimes it's maybe starting young with education. So this is something I personally believe in. The younger you start with the education, make it playful, integrate it in schools, even in kindergartens. You are never too young to learn what is a good food for you. Make it fun, make it playful, and then have the kids take that back into their parents' homes. So we have a multiplying effect. So behavioral insights in a variety of different ways, this is going to really help us, because as much as we as experts can talk about what the best diet should be,
sure,
we need to get this on the road. We need to get this going. We need to get people to actually adopt those things.
Absolutely. Thank you. I think that's such a great point about education and really starting that early and getting kids to have that multiplier effect that you talked about. We just have a minute really left. And because this panel is about food policies and creating better ones, I'm wondering if we can go back to Elise, maybe for 30 seconds, if you can explain, I know very quickly, about how to have more well-rounded food and agriculture policies.
Right. Well, I think one thing we really have to watch out for is there's nothing that could derail even the best intentioned policies more than them being not based on sound science and evidence-based decision-making. So it is incredibly important to make sure we've got the science right. We just completely dismantle public trust in government and in science if we don't do it right. And with sustainability, it's incredibly important to get us on the right path. And one of the ways to do that is what we've been talking about, is this systems approach. We need to make sure we have an inclusive inclusive approach that values the voices of stakeholders across the whole food system. And we get them to be part of this discussion and how we move forward together, because only moving forward together are we going to make valuable and meaningful changes to our food systems. That means we do have to pay attention that farmers are profitable. We do have to make sure that food system workers are making decent livelihoods in safe working conditions. The food is affordable, remains accessible. We need to make sure about environmental sustainability. We have to do everything at once. I mean, this is an incredibly challenging ambition we have in front of us. And I am hopeful. I will use the word hope, and I will say I am hopeful and optimistic that we can get there. Thank you. Thanks for including.
That's a great point to end on. I'm so sorry that we have to move on, but I think that point about moving forward together and the urgency that Brent mentioned before, I think is critical when we have these discussions. Thank you all so much. It was a pleasure to see you all and have you share your perspectives. Before moving to the next panel, I would like to remind everyone to share their thoughts on and comments using the hashtag Double Pyramid. We are receiving tons of messages via social media, which makes me really excited. And so we're thrilled by your participation. And if you wish to discover more about the science and the research behind the Double Pyramid, please download the full paper at BarillaCFN.com. So our final panel will focus on restoring the earth one meal at a time. And before I introduce the panelists, I would like to thank ALMA, the International School of Italian Cuisine, and all of the culinary schools around the globe that contributed with delicious recipes to the One Health Report. They are all on this next slide that I think you'll see right now. And let me just say a few words about ALMA. The International School of Italian Cuisine is recognized as the most authoritative professional training center dedicated to Italian hospitality at the international level. The school is part of an international network of leading culinary art and hospitality schools that share the mission of training competent and responsible professionals. ALMA involved 6 schools in the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition project on the Double Pyramid to promote creativity and gastronomic biodiversity through the guidelines of the Double Pyramid. And the schools represent regions from all over the world, including the George Brown School in Canada, CESA University in Mexico, the École des Culinaires de Miyagi in Japan, the Pruth Leith Chefs Academy in South Africa, and UOW Malaysia KDU University College. So a real diversity of regions there. Thanks again to all of the schools for sharing their expertise. So moving on to our panel, I'd like to introduce our panelists, including Riccardo Valentini, a professor at the University of Tuscia and the CMCC Foundation Strategic Advisor. Next, we have Don Bustos. If you could all unmute yourselves and come on the screen, that would be great. Next, we have Don Bustos, one of my favorite farmers in the world. He's a community organizer as well, living in New Mexico, and he is farming the same land that his ancestors have for over 400 years. And last but not least, we have Chef Chiara Pavan from Venice, who is considered one of Italy's greatest chefs and is a big supporter of hyper-local, sustainable, and healthy food production. So welcome to you all. So I'm wondering if we can have the slide of the Double Pyramid back, because Riccardo, I know you want to talk a little bit about it and build on what Gabriella said earlier, but maybe also address some of Elise Golan's concerns from the USDA about, you know, how dynamic the pyramid can be. And, you know, you've talked a lot to me and to many others about the science behind the pyramid, and that's really important for its legitimacy. So can you talk about, you know, the science behind it a little bit more?
Yes, thank you, Daniela, and hi, everybody. Yeah, it's really a pleasure to talk about the new Double Pyramid, because there is a lot of work in science, and it is very important because we need to provide people the most robust information that we have up to date, as also Gabriele mentioned before, for the health. And so also the environmental pyramid that is very nicely pair to pair with the health. So this is the message that is coming across, that we have to eat good for our health, but also for the planet. And that's exactly what the double pyramid represent. But I think the most important thing now is that in the last 10 years, we've done a lot of work. And also thanks to a European project, the Suitable Life project funded by the European Commission, we have been able to provide a new database, a new large database with more than 3,000 items of food calculated in terms of environmental footprints, like carbon footprints, in particular for double pyramid, but also water footprint, for example. And this database is public now, so everybody can get the data. And I think it's an important service we can do through the double pyramid project and also the Suitable Life project to the community of people that really want to know exactly what is the impact of the food. And now we can say that we know much more than before. And this has been also clear now in the climate policy, very well described from the IPCC report, that we have 37% of the greenhouse gas emissions are associated with the food. So what we put in our dish is absolutely relevant to the planet and to the atmosphere. And this is why we need also to go now in actions, okay, in real actions. It's something that people can really test themselves. There's a lot of social behavior components in that. And again, we are doing a lot of work now to bring into the canteens, for example, or in catering services, these principles of sustainability and health. And now we are also experiencing shift of the people behaviors. It's possible. So the question is whether in EU, for example, it's possible to do it. Yes, we can say today our data show that we can decrease by 30% of greenhouse gas emission with the appropriate sustainable diets. And that's, I think, for us also very interesting to, you know, in our experiments to have shown with this Suitable Life project. And I think it's an example that can be scaled up at the level of Europe and the world, possibly.
Absolutely. And I love how, you know, the pyramid, the double pyramid is so, you know, scientifically based. As you said, it's very rigorous, but then translating that science into the canteens and cafeterias and catering services, that's where the real secret sauce for me comes in.
Yes.
How do you get people
yes. Yeah, we I think at least 50% of our time we eat outside of the house, and somebody is serving the food to us, like chefs, for example, very important, because they provide the offer of the food. And so it's very important to have them on board. So I absolutely has to be very inclusive in this process. And we have to start from the food producers for us, that has to be educated and confident that there are sustainable menus and healthy menus to offer to the people.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, Don, as a farmer, I'm hoping to bring you into the discussion. We've talked, you know, Milione and Barbara talked at the beginning about creating resilient food systems, but native and indigenous food systems are often naturally resilient. And you know, they're depending not just on sort of the science that Ricardo's been talking about, but that sort of indigenous knowledge that has been accrued for centuries. And I'm wondering if you can talk about what that resilience really means in the context of your farming systems in New Mexico.
Thank you very much, Danielle. I really appreciate what all the other panelists have said, and it really has opened my mind even further how to use this tool. So I looked at this and I read the study, and I felt it's a really incredible tool for people working on the ground like myself, trying to organize our community and try to understand the impacts that our diet has on climate change directly, and how that climate change is affecting our social value and our social fabric in our communities. So it's impacted by our diet. I really like the way it addressed our diet. Is I tell people our diet here in northern New Mexico, where I grew up, is mostly from grazing. You know, we learned how to go out in the hills and how to work the fields and how to recognize the first kinds of, you know, people call them weeds, but they're actually really healthy food that we gather. And we start to gather that and gather that and then prepare it and eat that. And it starts off with really simple kinds of food, really simple weeds that we gather and then we eat. Then we transform that into a little bit better diets as we go through. So it's about how your diet is adaptable to your bioregions and not trying to change your region through commodification or industrialization. That's a displacement and a gentrification of communities and appropriate indigenous areas, communities. So when you start to impact these larger kind of industrial disciplines into a traditional communities, it disrupts the way we act and the way we look at it. So I thought this was a really good tool because it reinforces what we've known over centuries. Eat locally, eat what's appropriate, eat enough, but don't overeat. Sure. And then just use your natural resources in a real sustainable and holistic manner. I liked it because it was visual. I liked it because I thought it could be used in our communities very easily. And it's explainable. To me, it made a lot of sense. As other folks mentioned, that it's always, there is no silver bullet, and it's always a moving target. So we have to be able to recognize where we are in that spectrum and then adapt to the changes that are occurring at different points. To me, it really addressed what's occurring now in climate change and migration. You know, we take an isolation that food is part of the situation, is part of it, but it's part of the holistic view of how we're going to really look about what impacts we're having on a global level, locally, regionally, and then globally. Yeah, we all impact each other.
That's wonderful, and I think you're absolutely right. And I mean, what you were saying about the visual component of this, I think is so important, because you're right, people of any sort of culture, any sort of background can look at this and kind of get what it's saying. One of our other panelists, Don, talked about, lack of respect for indigenous foods. They're considered poor people's foods. And I'm wondering, from your perspective, how we switch that, how, you know, Brent was talking about marketing campaigns for healthy, you know, sustainable foods. How do we switch that? How do we get communities like yours or communities like mine to really respect those indigenous foods?
So I think it goes back to education, as one of the speakers said, about, you know, starting early in pre-kindergarten and really acknowledging what healthy food is and how it impacts your community. I think about, you know, this whole movement was about stop smoking here in the United States. And it took decades for people to really get into that stop smoking campaign. So when we look at about a movement, you're looking about several decades, and I know there seems to be a lot of pressure to change right away, but change is slow and it has to be adapted by communities. So it's a long haul that we're looking at, and just reinforcing, letting communities really define what it means for them to be healthy and to be independent. I think, you know, creating models, I always look about, how do you create a pilot project, or how do you create models? How do you do those measurements in small communities? And then once you see a community thriving or a model succeeding, other communities start to replicate it rather quickly because they see the success in it. So building one, then letting it replicate in a natural and in a holistic manner.
Absolutely. And thank you for the reminder about, you know, social movements are powerful, but they often take a lot of time. And so the more we can keep hammering away at this, I think the better. And I think that leads kind of perfectly into you, Chef Kiara. There's a lot of momentum that chefs have created, and they become such important leaders in recognizing the environmental impacts of food production and consumption, as well as, you know, protecting biodiversity, preventing food loss and food waste, and promoting equality. And so I'm wondering how you address some of the issues, you know, that I just mentioned and that are inherent in the double pyramid. How do you address those issues in your work?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for inviting me into this interesting discussion. So the first point is that we try to create balanced menu conditions, and through them, we struggle to get healthy and ecological behavior across. And second important point is the food waste reduction politics. we are carrying on. So about the first point, according to the double pyramid, we base our tasting menus on vegetables and fruit cultivated in our vegetable gardens. And we base our cuisine also on wild herbs and plants from the Venice Lagoon. Along with that, we decided to cut down animal proteins. We cut out beef and pork meat because they are foods that have a high carbon footprint. And we serve instead only game birds, which are traditional in Venice Lagoon cooking. And because the restaurant is located on a crane fishing village, we serve mainly local fish, but in definitely smaller portions compared to vegetables and cereals and whole grain cereals. I can say that we really serve a piece of fish with side dish. Instead, we use fish included fish offal, more like a condiment or a flavoring.
Sure.
We cut down eggs and dairy products that are used with moderation, and desserts are not so sweet. They are fresh, flowery, fruity. About the second point, the food waste reduction. First of all, we've been careful about portion sizes. Plates have to come back empty in the kitchen. And I must say that the tasting menu format helped us to achieve this goal because it is much easier to understand customer requirements. And maybe also speaking with them during the meal, you can pick the target and consequently cut down portions and the following curve. But when I mention food waste, I refer mainly to the part of products that we cannot use in any way, like, for example, part of vegetables, I don't know, kiwi skin, that we turn into biofertilizer for the garden. Or I refer, for instance, to fish heads and bones, okay, that we use with creativity to create tasty fermented sauces. So I think that with creativity, we struggle to push a sustainable way of cooking.
Absolutely, I think that creativity is key. And Don and Ricardo, I mean, you've all mentioned this idea of not eating too much and portion sizes. And I'm wondering, you know, especially in places like the United States, where we're used to getting, you know, big plates with big portions, how do we change that culture? And Don, maybe you can go first, because from, you know, my perspective, there's not a lot of waste in native cultures. And, you know, this idea of not eating too much, how do you, you know, sort of combat that idea that, you know, more is better?
You know, that's a really loaded question. I mean, I'm not a behavioral scientist or anything, and I think people have to change up what the concept of wealth is. I think that people believe that if you have big portions of food, it indicates more wealth in your society or in your culture. Whereas in other cultures where I come from, it's about sharing and to make sure that everybody has enough. It's not about one person or one entity taking over everything, but it's about sharing a very, very limited resource, and that limited resource is good, healthy food. And then the way it's grown is even more of a resource is water. So to me, it's about really being able to identify what it means and what it means to be healthy, and what it means to be responsible to your community, right? So it's part of what's going on now is trying to change people's perceptions of what it means to be wealthy and healthy and wise.
Absolutely, that beautifully put. And Ricardo, you know, in the canteens and cafeterias and catering services that you're working with in the Sweetable Life project, how do you encourage, you know, folks who are used to getting, maybe not so much in Italy, but again, in the United States, people are used to getting a certain amount of food and encouraging them to, you know, take smaller portion sizes?
Well, I think that the big portions is really a big problem, because not only for health but also for the environment. When, as it occur very very often, people waste the food because you order a lot, you give a lot, but you're not able to eat most of the cases, and you put on waste. And this is a precious land that we have used for producing that food. We have used water, we have used fertilizers, we have in some way polluted the environment to get that food that is thrown away. That's, I think, we tried in our experiments, there is also this guiding principle to reduce the food waste, and the caterers also they find interesting from the business point of view, because of course if you throw away the food is a cost for them. And so I think we have to find all the time this nudging, let's say, tools to bring together also economic issues and sustainability, because okay, we want people to make their own business, of course, if the food chefs and so on, but they can find a way, and so the waste is one point that we can really do a lot for that. It's a huge problem of sustainability. 40% of food is wasted. You know, it's more than four times the people we can eat, more than four times the people without food, you know, just serving this excess of food. So it's an ethical question as well. So I also appreciate what Don said about the responsibility of the community, and again, this is another point of responsibility.
Yeah,
I think we have now data to show this. We have to, of course, nudge, educate people to do, and also change the business models as well.
That's great.
That's what I like about the double pyramid, is that they broke it down into regions on a global level, so that if you want to eat something from somewhere else, well, go travel and visit, help us stimulate that economy instead of trying to replicate it and put it on an airplane and ship it across the globe.
Yeah, that's, I think, a good point, because otherwise you're moving across. We cannot impose any food, you know, to people. I mean, because if I can move the food from one place to another, it's even worse, you know. So we have to act on local food, you know. That is the only way to be sustainable.
Absolutely. And Chef Kimura, you've been doing a lot on local food that you talked about before, using game birds instead of other meats. And I'm wondering, you know, we only have like a few minutes left for this panel. You know, Chef, you talked a lot about using animal foods as a condiment, as a flavoring, that they're not the center of the plate. And, you know, I that's something that a lot of people aren't used to. They want, you know, a big piece of meat in as part of their dinner or lunch. How do we change the culture around, you know, animal protein?
The point is that how can we face intensive farming problem? This is the point. So could we really become all vegans? Many scientists say that it's not a choice for many reasons. First of all, because global population would starve without any animal protein supply, so we can't. And the answer is that we could for sure use less animal protein, we use less meat. As I said before, with creativity, we can cook legumes, whole grain cereals, and we can find other sources of protein as good as meat and fish. And we, like chef, we can try to do that and communicate that. And at home, we have to pass the message that at home, instead of eating meat five times a week, we should eat it once a week or fortnightly. And what is so important, we should diversify our meat consumption, eating different kinds of meat, because we eat only beef, pork, and poultry, maybe turkey in the United States. We could eat game. We could eat kind of birds that we are not used to. Meat that maybe was traditional in the past. And now I'm gonna add something. Maybe a little bit difficult, but probably in the not so far future, we should open our minds and start considering, I don't know, insects. I know it's a hard point, but or cultured meat as alternative protein sources. So I think on one hand, we should look at the past, at the tradition, and on the other hand, we should be looking at the future.
That's a wonderful point. I think, you know, going forward by looking back at some of the traditional ways of eating and also coming up with new innovations. And I love the point you made about having a diversity of meats. Again, the double pyramid is not about eliminating any food group or any kind of food. It's about eating more sustainably. I want to thank you all. I'm sorry I have to cut this short. This has been a wonderful discussion. Don, Ricardo, and Kiara, thank you so much for your expertise. And again, I want to remind folks, if they want to learn more about the double pyramid, they can go to BarillaCFN.com. And I want to thank you all for being with us today. Please keep using the hashtag double pyramid because this global journey is just really beginning. We will continue with more cultural discussions around food and the cultural pyramids with a series of interviews leading to World Earth Day on April 22nd. I think we have a slide to highlight those discussions, I hope. The double pyramid will also be discussed on Corriere TV in Italy during the webinar Planet 2021, and that is also on April 22nd. And I'm so excited for our closing speaker. I would like to leave the floor to UNESCO to summarize some of the key points that we've heard today around food and agriculture and sustainable and healthy diets. It's an incredible honor to have Paola Leoncini Bartoli, the Director of Cultural Policies and Development at UNESCO, join us. Over to you, Paola. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Danielle. I'm thrilled to be with you all, especially to come the last after listening to so many thought-provoking interventions that were spanning across policy level, community level, education, practice, catalyzing change. These are fundamental issues, and I believe that UNESCO is particularly well placed. You all know it's the UN Agency for Culture, Education, and the Sciences. So we are really at the knot of today's discussions. We believe at UNESCO, and this is very much what I have heard today, that food is really at the crossroads between culture and nature. It's two sides of the same coin. We are upholding in UNESCO cultural diversity as necessary for mankind, as biological diversity is for nature. This is a fundamental statement that we should all keep and cherish. It's the preamble of UNESCO's Declaration on Cultural Diversity, which was adopted by all our member states back in 2001. So it's the 10th anniversary today of this groundbreaking declaration. Food, we know, and we heard it by our experts, is shaped by culture, identity. It is shaped by place and by environment. So, and it forges our tradition and also leads us to innovate. So food is the most basic need of humanity. And we should always remember that it should remain a basic need. And this word is very important. We are, as UNESCO, of course, engaged in the promotion of the cultural, educational, and social dimensions of food to advance the 17 Sustainable Development Goals, which the pyramid, the double pyramid, is speaking to. This aspirational agenda 2030, and we are entering the last decade of action. Our collective challenge is to shape ultimately more adaptive society that are resilient, as you said, Danielle, earlier on, in order to cope with global and interdependent challenges. And food security is certainly one of such challenges. Our action is based on the recognition that food and culture are shaped by people, by their traditions, by their knowledge, and is transmitted from generation to generation. As such, food-related practices and traditions are an integral part of our living heritage, which we tend to call intangible, but which is truly our living heritage. They have forged our habits a long time, and they have also transformed our space. Now, the problem, as was said, is that globalization has the concept of space precisely, and it has accelerated mobility also for food, not just mobility of human beings, but mobility of food. That's how you get, for example, a raisin from Peru in the midst of the winter in Paris. And, you know, this mobility has also accelerated exchanges across the globe in an exponential way. Food has become an important element of cultural policy, but also cultural diplomacy and cultural influence. And we saw it with limitations in imports, exports. We saw it with the pandemic in which we are. You know, at the same time, food in the past has stimulated discoveries and intercultural dialogue, but today we see that many sectors are shaping the food systems compared to the past, and this at a global scale. We are speaking of infrastructures that shape the food system, tourism, transportation, information and technology, cultural and creative industries, design, photography, digital arts. All of this is shaping food, and food is getting influenced by this. So as it was said, we tend to forget the elementary and basic purpose of food, which is to ensure this creative and nourishing relation with mankind that food used to have. Yet food systems do not exist without oceans, land, and the environment. This is how food exists. So the global challenges such as population growth, enhanced mobility, climate change, that was voiced by many of the speakers, are increasingly affecting our lifestyle, including food-related practices. Now, UNESCO is carrying its work on food-related aspects, mainly through its standard-setting instruments. We have a set of cultural conventions. The most renowned of all is the World Heritage Convention, which grants labels and which embeds biosphere reserves, mixed cultural and natural sites that contribute to the livelihoods of many populations and communities, including indigenous communities, while at the same time, these conventions aim at preserving cultural and biological diversity. We, of course, also push forward programs such as education for sustainable development that prompts resilience and adaptation, and that also aims to promote from very young age education to sustainable development, both in formal and non-formal settings. Of course, the road is a long, winding road to take the Beatles song, and it takes a lot of time to embed education for sustainable development in curricula across all countries in the long term, at school and beyond school. I want to flag that the year 2020 marked also the 10th anniversary of the inscription of the Mediterranean Diet on UNESCO list of intangible cultural heritage. This was an achievement that is worth mentioning, I believe, because it was a joint achievement by a number of countries together: Cyprus, Croatia, Spain, Greece, Italy, Portugal, Morocco, underscoring the value precisely of the Mediterranean diet. Of course, as I said, the COVID-19 pandemic has struck the world at large, sparing no one, as was highlighted. But this has also highlighted the deficiencies in our food systems, which threatened thereby the lives and livelihoods of many people around the world, in particular, the most vulnerable ones. While the pandemic prompted us to reflect about the way we consume food, notably due to the lockdown, it has also shown the impacts of mass food production, food waste, and the impact of transformed consumption patterns on the livelihoods of people across the world. At the same time, the reduced human mobility due to lockdown has shown incredible positive returns on the environment, notably curbing pollution, as we all witnessed, with the reduction of traveling by plane and reduced mobility by car. And I think this is also important because it affected the whole food system chain. Against this background, let me just provide a few more remarks. We believe at UNESCO that investing in culture is essential. Culture and food are forged through know-how, skills, and education. Many speakers voiced the importance of traditional knowledge, of local and indigenous knowledge systems. This knowledge has to be passed from one generation to the other. Education is fundamental to that aspect. And of course, when we speak education and we speak of local knowledge, what combines the two is culture, is what we are, where we come from, what it makes meaning, has meaning to us. I heard the chef Chiara Pavan saying it loud and clear: we have to see what makes meaning, and we have to give new meaning to the biological diversity surrounding us. The concept of the double pyramid developed by the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition Foundation that we discussed today, I believe, represents a striking example of the transformative role of food in preserving this linkage between people and nature. And this is important. And I think that what this pyramid brings is clearly the same approach as Agenda 2030, meaning a holistic approach which lies at the core of the sustainable development goals. The pyramid shows that health and climate go hand in hand with the protection and promotion of cultural and biological diversity. I like to take your words, Danielle, diversity in all of this. This pyramid shows and is celebrating the diversity of food traditions and the diversity of food practices as powerful drivers of environmental sustainability and well-being. Therefore, bridging science, education, culture, as we do in UNESCO, based on our mandate, is critical to achieve a more sustainable future and to make this transformational change in our food system and food value chain. I would like to conclude by thanking, of course, BCFNF and the Food Tank for this event. Remind you all that we have a wonderful aspirational agenda, which is coming to reality little by little. This is the Agenda 2030, with a set of sustainable development goals that we all named today, even without verbalizing the agenda, from zero hunger to sustainable consumption, climate action, SDG 13, decent work, SDG 8, quality education, SDG 4, healthy life, SDG 3. We have to make this agenda not just aspirational, but reality through transformational change. So thank you for this opportunity, and I hope we'll have many more examples of these powerful double pyramid. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Paula. What a wonderful way to end this conference. And thank you for reinforcing that food is at the crossroads of culture and nature, and that we need to invest in culture and traditional knowledge. I want to thank the Barilla Foundation, all of our panelists and speakers, and all of you who are watching and listening for taking the time today to share this event with us and to share your thoughts via social media. These types of discussions are incredibly important as the world prepares for the UN Food System Summit. As we talked about before, national dialogues are taking place all over the world around the United Nations' five different action tracks for the UN Food System Summit on building more sustainable and resilient and healthy food systems. And what we've heard today really feeds directly into the conversations around Action Track 2, the shift to sustainable consumption patterns. And what we have learned today is that we can shift patterns of food production and consumption, waste less food, and transition to more nutrient-dense and delicious diets that don't place a burden on the planet. Just a reminder that the conversations around the cultural pyramids will continue next week with chefs from around the globe. I'm so excited about these discussions. And they will begin on April 19th, and you can follow them on foodtank.com. And please remember to keep the conversation going using the hashtag #DoublePyramid. Thank you all again. Please stay well and wear your masks. Thank you all again.